Sarah Lohman is a culinary historian and an author of the best-selling book, Eight Flavors, The Untold Story of American Cuisine. She focuses on the history of food as a way to access the stories of diverse Americans. Her work has been featured in The Wall Street Journal, The New York Times, and NPR. She has presented across the country from the Smithsonian Museum of American History in Washington, D.C., to the Culinary Historians of Southern California. Her current project, Endangered Eating, Exploring America's Vanishing Cuisine, will be released with W.W. Norton and Company in 2023. Tonight's program on the origins and history of the temperance movement. We'll explore how this movement came about and just how drunk America was in the 1820s. Then we'll see how they descended into the alarmist propaganda that brought about prohibition. Finally, we'll take a look at how the modern temperance movement has led to the rapid spread of dry January. Sarah will even include some tasty drink recipes. Thank you all for coming, and I'm going to hand it over to Sarah. Welcome.
Hi, everyone. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So it's always a pleasure to be here at Chelmsford, as you know. Tonight, we're going to talk about a topic that's of great interest to me, because I think that there's like the temperance movement has really gotten a bad rap and it's become sort of the butt of jokes. And I really think that it's a lot more complicated than that. So we're going to investigate sort of the origins of the alcohol-free movement and how we get to today. Now, that being said, what you see on your screen in front of you is a piece of propaganda created by the temperance movement in the 1840s about what will happen to you should you have a drink. And I will go through the different steps here. On the first one, step on the left side, step one is a glass with a friend. Step two is a glass to keep the cold out. And by the way, I have a clear version of this, because one of the things I think is really interesting, you just barely see her back there. But the person tending bar is a really an adorable young woman, which is always so interesting to me, because this image is from the 1830s or 40s, probably the 1840s, based on their outfits. And in that time, it was really inappropriate for women to be in bars. However, it was socially acceptable for women to own a bar or a tavern, or work in a bar or a tavern, especially if they were the family members of the owner. These were usually like family establishments. Oh, I see we've got a hand raised. Maybe Jill can help me out with that. Oh, I always forgot to mention that I do keep my chat open. So if you do have questions at any time, you're welcome to put them into the chat or use the Q&A feature too. I'll try to keep an eye on everything. But you know, if this is your first time hanging out with me, welcome. But I know that a lot of you have like been to these talks before. So we've got this lovely woman handing you a glass to keep the cold out. Step three is a glass too much. Step four is drunk and riotous. That's over here, these two men having a fight. And then step five, honestly, I can't lie, it looks like a great time. It says the summit attained, jolly confirmed drunk. But then step six is disease. Step seven is forsaken by friends. Step eight is desperation and crime. Step nine is death by suicide. So this does give you a taste for some of the scare tactics used by the temperance pressure. Do a lot of good things with this movement, and we'll talk about all of them. Okay, so my internet connection was unstable for a moment. Hopefully we are back. So, you know, there is this really negative temporary perception. Contemporary. This is a historical image for the 20th century of the temperance movement. And of course, the joke is lips that touch or shall not touch ours, as ooh, who do I make out with those ladies? Which is sexist. So like, not only is it mean, it's really sexist too. And the truth is that the temperance movement was not exclusively championed by women, but it is associated with, because particularly in the 19th and women had very little autonomy, and your life is very much tied to that of your husband. So if your husband was drinking away his paycheck every week and then coming home and there was physical abuse, and then it's really the women were the victims of people's actions. And so that is one major motivation behind the temperance movement. I want to call out to a lot of information that I'm getting, and maybe Jill can in the chat if this happens to be in your library system. This is The Alcoholic Republic by W.J. Rorabaugh. And this is like the book on early American drinking history and the temperance movement. In fact, these graphs I'm going to show you is based on data that this academic was able to put together. So what you're looking at, as you see, is the annual consumption of alcohol contained in all per capita in U.S. gallons. So we're not talking 4 gallons of beer, we're talking 4 gallons of ethyl alcohol. If you took the alcohol out of every spirit, beer, cider, wine, whatever people were drinking, and then added it all together, this is what it would look like. And you can see that when the data becomes more solid, it's a little before the turn of the 18th century. But in the 1830s, American hit an all-time high in terms of drinking, and every American was consuming about 4 gallons of pure ethanol per year per capita. So again, pure alcohol combined from all these differences. But then you see a really dramatic drop-off by the 1840s. And so we have 4 gallons per person, which, by the way, let me take a step back, because women, children, and the enslaved weren't drinking this much. So while statistic is per capita based on every man, woman, and child in the United States, the reality is when you look at just adult men, the numbers were quite a bit higher. Seems that adult men were drinking up to 20 gallons of ethanol per person per year. And what that translates to is basically 8 pure alcohol. It's like a measuring cup full of devil's cut vodka every single day. So that is a huge amount of alcohol to consume. Okay. Oh, I see. There's such a great question from the Opera Addict. The Opera Addict says, wasn't it safer to drink alcohol than water in those days? I get there. Oh, I promise you. It's one of my favorite questions. So, well, all right. We can look at it right here. Opera Addict, that is something I've heard again and again. It's really a sort of oft-repeated idea. And I actually think that has more to do with America's religious conservatism, that we wanted to come up with a logical reason why Americans of the past drank more than they do today. But we can disprove that idea just looking at this graph. Because while we peaked at four alcohols per person per gallon, that drop-off, where we drop to less than a gallon per person per year, that's the effects of the temperance movement. And we're talking about the difference of 20 years, 1820 to 1840. So if we're talking about water quality, we're still in the early 19th century, and there weren't significant changes to water quality within those 20 years. So we both have to examine that idea and really ask the question of why were people drinking and drinking so much? And then why did people stop drinking basically within the same era? We're going to get to all of that. And then you see there's also a second drop off in the 1920s. And of course, that is prohibition. I think that another really popular myth about Americans' consumption of alcohol is that prohibition didn't work. Now, we are going to talk about aspects of prohibition that didn't work. But as far as its ultimate goal of getting Americans to drink less, you can see that it was really quite effective. We hit our lowest point of alcohol consumption as a country during the era of prohibition. So let's examine this all a little bit further, because I know this challenges a lot of ideas we have about the history of drinking in America. Out of curiosity, Jill and I were just talking that Jill's doing a dry January herself. Is anyone else doing dry January this year? You can pop it in the chat and let me know. I was just saying too that I don't because my birthday is January 15th. So I want to keep myself open. But I think that I should also point out too that we've also been on the upswing as far as our drinking habits. Modern statistics say that we drink about, So we drink a little under 2.5 gallons of alcohol per capita per year. And interestingly, as compared to the 19th century, this is more evenly divided in terms of now, children aren't drinking, but women are drinking and people of color are drinking as well. And in fact, those are the two major groups where drinking is on the rise, women and minorities. So we're gonna examine that a little bit more as well, but you have to wait for the answers. Okay, so here it is. People drank more back then because the water wasn't good, right? Okay, so definitely this was an issue in Europe in the Middle Ages in the and the Renaissance period. So we're talking, you know, a couple hundred years before the era of American being its most drunk in the 1820s. There were definitely problems with sanitation in Europe, especially we didn't really understand germ theory. But conversely, something else to challenge that, America was actually known for its clean water. Yes, certainly in urban environments, there were some issues with water cleanliness, especially in the early to mid 19th century. In New York City, for example, the wells were brackish because New York is right there on the water, and there were issues with cholera and dysentery in the summertime. But by the 1840s, New York had the Croton Aqueduct, which was bringing fresh water from upstate, actually from the same water source that New York still uses today, the natural limestone filtered water. Additionally, when we think about things like how famous America is for bourbon, Kentucky and Tennessee bourbon, we became really well known for our spirits because of the clarity and the taste of our water. So it really has less to do with water being drinkable, especially by the mid-19th century, because there were different water sources being tapped into to remedy poor water in urban areas, and in rural areas, our water was actually quite good. So why do people drink? So when I get this question, one of the things that I like to throw out there is think to yourself about why we drink today. I drink, and it's certainly not because the water is of bad quality, right? So if that was the reason that people drank in the past, then we wouldn't be drinking today. We'd all be, you know, drinking some bottled water or some Brita filtered water. One of the big reasons that I drink is for community. And I think that that's something that we can all think about, that you are going out to a bar and meeting people, you're in people over, it's much like a cup of coffee to sit down and have a conversation with friends. And that was definitely true in the past. If you're talking about a rural environment, the local tavern might be the only place where like all of the farmers who live in really disparate areas can come together and drink. Again, these were male so it was about male community, but still. And additionally, in places like New York City, which I think I have a, we'll come back to that. There were living spaces to this day are still very tight. So even in the 21st, there are a lot of bars, coffee shops in New York City, because people need that space to meet up outside of their homes when they don't have the space to invite people over. So historically that was true as well. And bars have been a big part of New York City culture since the early 19th century. One of the simplest reasons people drank so much alcohol in the past is because they had less choice in terms of beverage. Today, you know, you can go to any gas station, and in this snapshot alone, there are at least a dozen different types of soda. There are a million flavors of Gatorade. There are a bunch of bottles of water. We haven't even gotten into things like seltzer, right? So especially if coffee and tea were expensive and you don't have a lot of beverage options, if people got sick of drinking water, then they would turn to the wide variety of alcoholic beverages. In early, like very early 19th century and late 18th century, that was mostly cider. And then by the German immigration really kicks in the 1840s through 1860s, that Americans are drinking a lot more of lager. Both of these things are very low as far as the APV, the percentage of alcohol volume in it. And even our founding fathers, most of whom consider themselves temperate, didn't even consider cider or beer to be alcoholic. Like 4 to 6% was considered normal in this era. The temperance movement early on really focused on like spirits, distilled alcohol too. There were a few alternatives. You could drink milk when milk was in season. Milk is seasonal, even though it's not today. You can drink lemonade if you had enough money to get lemons. And there were a couple other beverages which are making, I think, a really interesting comeback in shrubs and switchels. I'm curious if anyone has ever tried a shrub or a switchel. A shrub is, we could even call it like a really early version of soda, in that it is usually, it was a way to preserve like a bumper crop of fruit. You take fruit, you cook it with sugar, and then you squeeze the syrup and then add an equal part of vinegar. So it is this really restorative, like sweet and sour drink that you mixed either with cold water or with seltzer water. Mineral waters have been available since the 17th century, and then seltzer became a thing by the second half of the 19th century. And switchel is a similar sort of sweet and sour drink that was usually made with molasses, brown sugar, maple syrup to, just depending what part of the country you were in, plus usually something a little acidic, and then you mix that in with water too. So these are things you can start. You've made herbs and shrubs. Oh, that's really cool, Pamela. Yeah, I've made some shrubs before. I've never made a switchel, but the switchel in particular has been compared to basically like the Gatorade of the past. Roman soldiers drank a drink very similar to switchel that used like grape vinegar in it as well. So these are, I keep calling them restorative, but they're basically restoring electrolytes and sort of energy. Is it similar to simple syrup? So simple syrup is just sugar and water cooked together one-to-one to make a syrup. And usually simple syrup is made with cocktails because you can't dissolve sugar in cocktails. It needs to already be dissolved. So in a way, yeah, because you're usually adding equal parts fruit and sugar together and then boiling it. So it's almost like this fruit flavored simple syrup that then you mix one-to-one with vinegar, and then that is the shelf stable component. And then you use a tablespoon of that and mix it with seltzer or water. Really, it's tasty. And actually shrubs are still very popular in Asian countries too. So you can, if you go to like your local Chinese grocery store too, or your pan-Asian grocery store, you can usually find versions of these like vinegar and fruit drinks. But they are making a sort of a comeback too as an alternate to soda. But again, keep in mind, they are still full of sugar, but I do find them a little tastier. It's more of a complicated flavor. So while there were other beverages, there just simply wasn't the options that we have today. So I mentioned community already. This is an illustration of a German beer garden in New York City, which in some ways looks like a lot of fun, and in other ways is playing on some stereotypes. You can see on the right-hand side here, there is a toddler and a baby who are also drinking beer. That was a big stereotype of German bars. But that's because German bars, especially on Sundays, were really family affairs. I've said a couple times now that American bars were male-only environments, but looking around this picture, you can see lots of women in this image. You can see that there's music being played here, that there's a performance. Beer halls could be really small spaces too. This is one of the really, really big ones. And it even specifies that this is on a Sunday evening. So Sunday was the one day off you had during the week, especially if you were doing factory work in cities. And so in the morning, especially in the German neighborhood, you went to church in the morning, and then you went out to the German beer hall in your best clothes with your whole family. As part of this experience, there was food served for free. As long as you bought a beer, you got access to the free lunch table. So that's another way you brought the whole family. And rather than mom being at home all the time taking care of the kids, everyone just came together. The kids ran around and played. They had sausages and pretzels to eat. There was music, and the adults could spend time together too. And again, in an environment where the housing was very small and very often very crowded, even in the early 19th century, these spaces provided a new living room for the community, somewhere outside of your home that was welcome to people of all genders and ages, essentially. But you really had to come as a family unit. There were still some prohibitions against women drinking alone too, or women drinking in groups together. Ladies' nights were not allowed. So community, whether it's urban or rural, was a huge part of the urge to drink in the early 20th century. But there were also some sort of malevolent things going on too. You know, we very specifically have this peak of drinking in the 1820s, and it's a time that historians have pointed to that there was a lot of anxiety within America at that time. We were still a very new nation, not really even 50 years old. We had been engaged with two wars with Britain, as well as, especially if you're living on the frontier, there is this constant fear of attack from native peoples, not unwarranted considering we were colonizing their land, but there was a lot of struggle in this era. President Andrew Jackson had been elected to two terms as president, despite the fact that he was a wildly unpopular president and was considered violent and divisive even within the era. And there was a lot of economic instability. There wasn't a Federal Reserve. And so it was very hard to maintain any sort of, what am I trying to say here? Economic stability within America's early economy. I found the words. It came up very complicated, but that is the truth. So there was just a lot of stress in that time as well. And I should say, as since we were kind of a cash poor country, cash as in like dollar bills or even checks were really only used in large cities. So if you were a farmer on the frontier, which in the 18th century was like Pennsylvania, you were taking crops like wheat or apples and converting them to alcohol before sale, because that made them infinitely shelf stable and also more valuable. They were easier to transport and you could sell them for more than a cart of wheat or a barrel of apples too. So also alcohol was used as currency within this time too, and often traded for goods and services as well. I'm trying to see if we missed any other anxieties. So yeah, I mean, here, what was the title of that first book? Oh, sorry. The first book was called The Alcoholic Republic, a really, really, really great book to read. So just let me read you my notes on what was going on at this time of the country. Nothing was stable. Currency was unstable or non-existent. We were a new country. We had no money as a country. We were at war all the time. People moved out to the frontier and tried to make a life with no government support. All work was grueling. Most people were poor. Their job was being replaced by the Industrial Revolution. People felt a loss of autonomy. People died quickly and constantly. One of the biggest changes from the 19th to the 20th century, two biggest changes in terms of health are antibiotics, of course, but also accidents. Since there wasn't any OSHA or any laws about how you had to treat your employees, people died by accidents at a significantly higher rate than they did in the 20th century. So it was a really anxiety-inducing time. And one of the ways that people exercised their autonomy was through drinking. Men would go out and drink publicly. Women would drink in a couple different ways that we're going to talk about. But one of them was there are often bars in the back of grocery stores, and that's where women would drink together. And people sort of laugh at that today, but that's also a trend that's coming back too. Like Whole Foods has beer on tap that you can like put in your cart and scoot around. There's a couple of grocery stores that I know of locally where you can, I mean, yes, I live in Las Vegas, but also in Cleveland, where you can like buy a beer at the bar and then go do your grocery shopping. And you do indeed buy more groceries after you've had a beer. That is true. Women also tended to drink by taking your bitters. Alcohol at this time was considered medicine. And in some ways it was. Alcohol was better to take out the essential oils and different chemicals. It was easier to make an extraction with when you were putting in herbs or spices. So something like cocktail bitters, those were actually originally created as a medicine. Angostura is one of the oldest that's still on market. It was created in the 1830s as a stomach remedy. And actually it uses many spices that are quite good at settling your stomach. They were actually never quite made illegal during Prohibition because they are considered medicine. And today you buy them in grocery stores because they're qualified as an extract, not an alcohol, which is in upper Minnesota, I believe, maybe upper Wisconsin as well, like the upper Midwest. That was one ways that bars stayed open, that they just serve shots of Angostura or other bitters as opposed to alcoholic beverages. So bitters were considered a medicine. The American armies through the early 19th century were given a dram of bitters every morning as part of taking your medicine. So it was really common for Americans to get up and do a shot of bitters. And it was a common thing for women to do too. It's considered healthy. But of course you might be taking more than one. And so this was a way that women were abusing alcohol within their homes as well. So one of the most concerning aspects of drinking at this time, scholars have deemed the communal binge, where again, since you felt so out of control about everything else in your life, including your own life, you felt like you could die at any moment, people would just go out to the bars and get wasted. If anything, it sounds a little bit familiar, that makes a lot of sense. We're also in a very, very stressful time too. We're going to talk about that. So this wasn't in any way sort of a moderate consumption of alcohol or a mature consumption of alcohol. When you went out to drink, you went out and got wasted. And again, these are largely male-only spaces, although again, this illustration is probably of a German saloon because the dog is there, the kids are there, the women are there, but still the drinking was considered problematic. So out of curiosity to see exactly how much of a problem this was, a decade ago now, almost to the day, I did this a day in January, I decided to try to drink like a colonial American. And this is what I drank and when was based on research in Rohrbach's book. I'm going to read to you a quote of like what colonial Americans drank every day and when they drank it. So Rohrbach writes, Americans drank not only at any place, but at any time. Some began to imbibe even before breakfast with an eye-opener concocted of rum, whiskey, or gin mixed with bitters. In one Rhode Island factory town, laborers going to work made their way through the dawn's early light to the tavern to take a little drop. Gentlemen adjourned from business at 11 a.m. for the old-fashioned equivalent of the coffee break, the 11s, an occasion for partaking a spirituous liqueur. When the weather was cold, they might have hot toddies made of whiskey or rum, sugar, and hot water, or hot slings made of gin, sugar, and hot water, and nutmeg. The Virginia gentry gathered at 1 p.m. for the purpose of taking juleps compounded of peach brandy, whiskey, sugar, and ice. Throughout America, early afternoon dinner was accompanied by hard cider or distilled spirits mixed with water. In late afternoon came another break, then supper with more refreshment. Finally, in the evening, it was time to pause and reflect upon the day's events while sitting by the home or the tavern fireside sipping spirits. So when I embarked on this, I kind of thought that I would be like, since it's sort of spread out over a day, yes, it's a lot of alcohol. I thought I'd be sort of consistently tipsy throughout the day. But the reality is I was just going through cycles of being drunk and hungover all day long. It just made me a little sick to my stomach, even though I did this 10 years ago to think about it. It was really a miserable day. This is an 1830s recipe for an apple hot toddy, which is very enjoyable. A little baked apple slice with apple brandy and hot water, a little cinnamon too. Very, very tasty. At the time I was doing this a decade ago, there also hadn't been such an explosion in the cider industry as there is today. So the only accessible cider was woodchuck, which is very, very sweet if you've had it, and not like the dry ciders that are available now, especially in New England. So I did the whole thing. Well, not really. I fell asleep at 3 p.m. and woke up really, really hungover. And so I didn't even make it to supper drinks or the after dinner drinks at the tavern. It was absolutely miserable. So as you can see, I was way down the ladder on the other side. And this is definitely more about the community of it, the control of it, the freedom of it, the escapism of it, than it is necessarily about replacing water consumption, especially because in a lot of those, you're mixing water in with the drinks as well. And again, the temperance movement really starts too because of the way this is predominantly men drinking this much and the way that it's affecting their families back home too. So let's talk about what actually happens and how the temperance movement came to be. So it was a group of Calvinist ministers, who were actually in training to be ministers, who came up with this idea. When I search like Calvinist ministers, that's the image that came up. I don't get it, but maybe if there's any Calvinists out there, you will understand it. But basically the Calvinists in the 1830s were talking about this issue of American drunkenness and what could be done about it. And so they created this idea of the temperance movement, which really, really focused on this idea of community. So the temperance movement succeeded because of this idea of community. Because people were going out to drink so that they didn't feel alone, so they had the support of their friends so that they could escape. So the idea behind the temperance movement starting in the 1830s was to provide a safe space for that without the consumption of alcohol. So there were these big parties. It felt a lot like a secret club because you would take this pledge together. Thank you. If you're interested in reading Alcoholic Republic, a link is in the chat right now. You would sign a pledge, which is what people are doing down here on the corner, and I'll show you an example of that. So it's like a Boy Scout or Girl Scout kind of club that you're all together. This was also a mixed environment, and obviously meaning men and women, but also it was a safe environment for children as well, so the family could be together. You've got the happy, cute organ player there. So it doesn't have to be religious, but it is attached to religion. The modern comparison I can make is like AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, where it is temperate, but connected to religion. Although again, those two things don't necessarily have to go together. So it was about not just the temperance movement being this cool club that you can be in, but also religion filling that place of anxiety or uncertainty instead of alcohol. And that was happening a lot in this era. The other really interesting thing that happens in the 1830s and 1840s, in addition to the temperance movement, is the proliferation of cults. I do another talk about cults in America, and a lot of sort of Christian adjacent cults start in this time. To be fair, any religion started as a cult, it becomes religion when it gets more famous. Christianity was considered a cult by the Romans. But in this case, we see a lot of people who are seeking and seeking answers. Again, we sort of see that again in the 1970s, and then we're seeing it again today. The big boom in astrology has a lot to do with that too. And they're seeking community. They want to feel like they're belonging and also like they can get more out of life. We have these very, we've always had these very human ideas, and they were really big in the 1830s and 1840s. If you think you haven't heard of any of the cults of the 1830s and 1840s, Mormonism started in the 1830s. Again, now it's very successful, so it is a religion, but it was a separatist Christian movement that started in upstate New York in the 1830s. So it's coming out of this time of seeking. So there is a huge resurgence in religion, whereas 30 years earlier, like it's something like less than 25% of Americans were attending church every Sunday. We see a big change at the same time that the temperance movement is catching up. And then of course, like it started this movement for spaces where temperate drinks were sold. So modern day coffee houses and tea houses are sort of a descendant of that in America. Of course, soda shops became very, very popular and successful during Prohibition. And again, these were spaces that could be family spaces as opposed to men only spaces too. So a lot of this was also connected to women wanting to have autonomy and have a social life outside of their domestic environment as well. And it's funny too, because there is still in England, these temperance bars too. And definitely there were places labeled temperance bars in the 19th century. And luckily today we have so many social spaces that are inclusive of men, women, and families that don't involve alcohol too. But that really wasn't an option in the 19th century. So they had to be created. This is what a temperance pledge looked like. Again, it really made you feel like you were part of something. And it was also considered very American within the temperance movement. Becoming sober was referred to as our second national independence. The first one was from Britain, and now we're going to be independent from alcohol too. But even though that was the origin point and the reason why the temperance movement was successful, it also had some very negative aspects to it as well. I already showed you one piece of propaganda. There was a lot of propaganda that really dwelt on the violence the alcohol abuse caused, which it's not that that didn't exist. It's just that it became very alarmist and very extremist by the middle of the 19th century. And additionally, it relied on ideas of shame and even as far as like burning in hell if you consume alcohol. So there was this sort of, well, the best way to put it is like, and Satan basically began to associate alcohol with Satan as a way to shame people into sobriety. And this was really associated with the thing that comes out of this really spiritual and religious movement of the 1830s and 1840s is by the middle to late 19th century, we have evangelicalism and Christian cults as well. So these become really extremist societies where there's a very narrow idea of what or who is good, and alcohol exists outside of that. So of course, this is very problematic because anyone who is dealing with alcoholism or alcohol abuse should not be shamed for that. They should be supported. So in some ways, this worked really against those earlier ideas of community and support and we got you. Versus the like, if you falter, if you fail, if you drink, you're going to burn in hell. And that is not only not an effective way to put someone on the path of sobriety, but it's extremely destructive as well. So a lot of those ideas come out of the mid 19th century. And since the evangelical movement was really headed by women, that is also why the sort of negative perception of the temperance movement is associated with women. But again, it had a lot more to do with women seeking autonomy, women not wanting their husbands to drink their money away or beat them, and also women wanting to have their own community and public spaces that they were allowed to be in. And this is one of the few spaces, church spaces, where they were allowed to gather and also achieve too. So this evangelicalism is what leads to Prohibition, because since this is largely obviously, one, within 20 years, the temperance movement successfully halved America's alcohol consumption, which is pretty incredible. But the movement kept moving and kept pushing so that by 1919, America voted a dry country. And this in itself was problematic because it has a lot to do with the fact that it violates the separation of church and state, that these were Christian organizations that were pressing the government to make this rule based on what were seen as Christian values. So whereas this is the only amendment in our history that actually took away a right rather than giving a right. And so that's why there is today a lot of talk about all of the amendments that people say should be added to the Constitution, like taking away a woman's right to an abortion, that again, we're talking about that that's not our country's history, that we are a country that should be giving rights, not taking them away. So this, at the moment at least, is the one time in our history we took away people's right to drink. And actually, not technically. People were allowed to drink, but you weren't allowed to sell alcohol. So it's treated like a lot of other controlled substances in America is today, including marijuana and still today in most states. Having it or consuming it is not illegal, but buying or selling it is. So, you know, as we can see, it worked. That in the 1920s, we hit this all-time low in our consumption of alcohol. There are ways that it didn't work, the one I already mentioned, and that this is a violation of the separation of church and state. But also, wait, I'm going to pull up some statistics for you. Okay. We're doing pretty good. So from a drinker's perspective too, prohibition really destroyed the spirits brewing industries and also basically cocktail knowledge. And it took a really long time to get that knowledge back, especially because when it was lifted, we were in a depression and then headed into World War II, when it was really difficult to both access spirits from other countries, but also the manual labor wasn't available in America to continue brewing or distilling. Also, after prohibition, licenses were limited to really, really big companies. So for the 20th century, we had like Budweiser and Jack Daniels, but we didn't really have a lot of small independent companies and variety in what we were able to drink. That changed by the late 20th century, and certainly in the 21st century, a lot of states and national laws have been changed to allow that. More importantly, America made a lot of its money from taxing alcohol and still does. So during Prohibition, the American government lost $11 billion in tax revenues, and that's in 1920s money. And it also cost $300 million to enforce because it also created this illicit industry of supplying alcohol. So it was incredibly taxing, huh, on the American government and on our supplies. So on one hand, it can be considered a success. Americans were drinking very, very little, both due to access to alcohol, but also social pressure at the time. So this sort of idea that like, Americans actually drank more back then, not true. It was very successful to the point where we lost a lot of knowledge in terms of how to make good alcohol. And I'm doing research right now for my next book on heirloom cider apples. And we lost a lot of those cider apples because orchardists and even small farmers were cutting down their trees, not only because there wasn't a market for those apples that you'd make cider out of, but because you were sort of like looked askance if you had a cider apple tree in your yard, a little bit like, what are you doing with those apples, you know? But as I mentioned already, drinking is on the rise. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that we are once again living in a very, very anxious time. I don't know if you've noticed, including the pandemic.
So there is an institution which, let me see if I have the name written in my notes. I might have to look it up. But also, Jill, if you look up America's top 10 fears, you'll be able to find the name of the organization that does this and maybe provide a link. But basically, every year, a certain study looks at what things Americans are really, really anxious about. And it's fascinating to me on another level, because since I wrote this talk originally in 2018, and I usually do it annually at least once, and it is sort of sad and fascinating to look at how our anxieties have changed over time, like year to year. Like, for example, this is last year's top 10 fears from 2021. So it makes sense that during a pandemic, loved ones dying or loved ones becoming seriously ill are going to be our greatest fears. And now, no, it's not Beer Advocate that does it, although they might republish the studies. I'm looking again in my notes to see if I have it in here. It does not look like I do. I apologize. But again, if you look up top 10 fears, I might do it really, really quickly at the end of this talk. Here is 2022's top 10 fears. So we've got corrupt government officials. Again, people I love being seriously ill. Russia is suddenly up there too, where it didn't even make the top 10 in the past. So we still see those pandemic anxieties, but now we see things like the US becoming involved in another world war being up there as well. Climate change factors and other environmental factors like pollution of water, pollution of oceans, rivers, and lakes, and climate change in general, those tend to be in and out of like the bottom half of the top 10. So there's a lot of things that make us very, very worried currently. And this is from last year as well. So 2020 to 2021, another study looked at how much our anxiety levels have increased over a year. And nearly half of all people polled said that they were more anxious or much more anxious than they were the year before. So looking at that historically in the 1820s, also a very independently anxious time where we felt like we had very little control over our lives. We're seeing a lot of that now as well. So many big, big things are happening that feel out of our control. But I think the biggest shift between 1820 and 2020 is that we don't just rely on alcohol to feel in control. We also look at the abstainment from alcohol to feel in control. We can make changes in our diet and our habits to make ourselves feel better. And that's sort of what Dry January promotes. So Dry January actually started in Britain. It started in 2013. And originally 4,000 people did Dry January. And now in the last year, you're looking at somewhere in the neighborhood, somewhere upwards of 4 million people do Dry January each year. One survey in Canada says that as many as 1 in 3 adults, so a third of all people above drinking age, give up alcohol for Dry January. Thank you, Linda. Linda, just the Chapman University survey. It's in there. Thank you, Linda. I appreciate it. I like a footnote so you don't think I'm just like making things up over here. The other big difference that I find is really fascinating is that the temperance movement of the 19th century really talked about community and community goals, that by if we stop drinking, we can sort of work together to be a better America together, that we'll have more money, energy, and time to focus on our families, yes, but also on building this new nation. That was part of the idea of like, this is our second independence and the eagles and the flags on our temperance pledge, that it also connected with this idea of community. It is interesting that in the 21st century, we've moved away from that idea of community a little bit when it comes to temperance, and it's more about making good choices for yourself and for your own health. So that could be bad. I'm not really sure. I think it's open to interpretation. But I will say that studies, because Dry January has been so successful and has now been running for a decade, there have been studies done to see if there are any long-term health effects. And it has been shown I want to read you the exact statistics. So a new survey suggests that alcohol-free challenge reduces consumption for months afterwards. People who have participated in Dry January report having one extra dry day per week. There was also considerable immediate benefits in that 9 out of 10 people saved money, 7 in 10 slept better, and 3 in 5 lost weight. So basically, and this is a quote from one of the people who did the study, that means for the rest of the year, we are better able to make decisions about our drinking and to avoid slipping into drinking more than we really want to. So by taking a month to be sober, it shows that for the rest of the year, you tend to make better choices about alcohol consumption, which is a really beneficial long-term result. So that is just a little bit about the history of temperance movement. Of course, you can see the effects of movements like Dry January on our grocery store shelves to this day, in that we have an incredible, delightful assortment of both sugar-free and non-alcoholic drinks and seltzer. But also you've probably noticed how many non-alcoholic beers and spirits are out there. There are over 100 different liquor brands that are producing non-alcoholic liquor. And whereas non-alcoholic beer used to be sort of like bleh. Or then it was made by very, very small brands. Now all of the major brands like Heineken and Budweiser also produce 0% beer. So there are so many more options for us. And also one of the things that I noticed in the past decade that I really love is that I still want to go to those bars for community, but there are a variety of reasons that any person might not drink. It might be lifelong sobriety. It might be dry January, but also you might be on antibiotics, right? And it's, or also you just might not want to drink that day. And so I used to feel weird about going into a bar and you kind of get a look or a scoff if you just ordered some seltzer with bitters. But finally, bars have gotten on board, and usually, especially at cocktail bars, but you see it all over the place, there is a list of non-alcoholic cocktails to choose from on its own separate special menu. So you get to still feel like an adult by ordering something special and not be drinking. And that makes a lot of sense. Bars should want my money, whether or not I'm drinking alcohol or not, because my friends are probably there drinking too. So I love that there's been a bigger cultural shift. It's like, why aren't you drinking? You should be drinking. To people can do whatever they want and make their own choices, and we can do away with that social pressure. So as always, this has been Sarah Lohman. If you've got any questions, you're welcome to pop them in the chat now or pop them in the Q&A, and I'm happy to answer them. My contact information is there. You can always see what upcoming talks I have at sarahlohman.com. And my social media is at 4 Pounds Flower. That's both on Instagram and Facebook, but you can always just search me by name too. My first book, 8 Flavors, is out and it's in your library. My next book, Endangered Eating, is going to come out in October of 2023. And I'm really, really excited about it. Hi, Opera Addict. Do the temperance also apply to alcohol use in cooking, coq au vin, rum cake? So during Prohibition, there were pretty extensive bans on those. You could get bitters, like I said, but a lot of bitters companies went out of business during that time too. You could get extracts like vanilla or almond extract, and you could get what was known as medicinal alcohol too. You know, there were ways to get alcohol. And again, like home brewing or home winemaking was never explicitly outlawed. It was just sort of like looked askance. So in the 20s, you don't really see a lot of American recipes that are using alcohol in cooking. And yeah, I don't think you would have been able to buy the wine or the rum that you needed to make French recipes like the one that you're mentioning. Prohibition was a terrible idea. Freedom of choice and support for people who don't want to drink is a fantastic idea. Did the Irish really drink more than other groups, or was that just an anti-immigrant propaganda? You know, I'm glad you brought that up too, because one of the things that I didn't touch on is I think one of the ideas about the temperance movement, and I think that this did play out at a certain point, was anti-German and anti-Irish propaganda. The Irish, it's not that they necessarily drank more. It's that as compared to other immigrant groups, their culture was really based more around drinking than it was around food. So that was how they sort of transferred their cultural identity. And then of course with the Germans, who I did mention a lot, they had these German beer halls. So there was and could be anti-immigrant sentiment attached to the temperance movement, but I just qualify it as like, that's not why the temperance movement was successful. It wouldn't have been successful. It was just a movement based on hate. I see your question too, Linda. And I should say, one of the talks I'd love to give for you guys is I do a history of Irish food and sort of talk a little bit more about that. We'll see if we can get them to put on the schedule for March. Linda, and then I'm going to come to Adele. So do you have data on the uptick of drinking during COVID lockdowns? No, I sort of looked around today, and it might just be a little bit too soon to have that data. One of the things, let's see. Oh, it's, I'm trying to think like if I can look up like America per capita drinking. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that there wasn't a noticeable uptick, although it felt like it. It was just the difference between drinking at home alone or with a partner than as opposed to going out and drinking. But you know what? I'm going to see if I can dig up more statistics. Again, it might just be a little bit too soon. Things tend to lag by a year or two. And we'll see. But I had that same sort of thought and question. If there was a difference, or honestly, I drank a lot less during the pandemic. So I'm very much a social drinker, right? Adele, so which other countries had temperance prohibition movements? Where are the parallels among those movements? It was mostly us. You definitely saw, in terms of Prohibition. There were temperance movements in Europe, most notably in France and England, and they were based on some of the same propaganda ideas. Like there was very famously a pretty brutal murder case the guy was convicted based on like how much he was drinking, and the temperance movement really used that as an idea for sobriety. This happened in France, but that was actually sort of, that propaganda was funded by the wine and brandy industry, because they had just gone through a huge blight. And when wine became like basically unavailable in the middle of the 19th century, people started drinking absinthe. And so absinthe specifically was blamed for making this guy be crazy and murder his family. But it was because the wine industry wanted people to come back and drink wine. So the temperance movements weren't terribly successful. And a lot of our most famous bartenders, because America was really known as like the cocktail country, went abroad. They went to the Caribbean, they went to England, they went to France, they went to other parts of Europe. So again, we had this brain drain of like drinks knowledge, because in order to work in those fields, whether it's behind a bar or as a vintner or a distiller, you had to go abroad. So there were a lot of American expats that went to the Caribbean or Europe during that time, so they continue practicing their art. Great. So there, Jill just dropped an article in the chat about COVID-related drinking and a rise in liver disease. It's been a tough couple years, y'all. I mean, and again, this follows the historical trends of, again, in anxious times, we tend to turn towards drinking too. The lyrics to the Yiddish song Prohibition, with words and music by Reuben Doctor, lament the institution of prohibition. The translated refrain is prohibition, prohibition, no more drinking. Prohibition, prohibition, I tell you not a bit. He who a bit of schnapps would buy, most to Europe fly, prohibition, prohibition is now the law of the land. So there you go. Like, it's basically saying that if you want to do any drinking, you've got to go to Europe. So again, I think the idea of I'm always against separating church and state. That is the idea that our country was based on. It's very bizarre to me. The part of the new, like very religious political movement is saying that our founding fathers would have wanted it this way. They were agnostics. They were from a lot of different backgrounds, even that early on, and a lot of different faiths. Again, we were a hugely German country, even in that moment. And they specifically said separation of church and state. And so when those two things combine, you get something like prohibition, which is a violation of people's rights, their right to choose, literally, in this case, whether to drink or not. So it was really kind of a disaster in that way, because culturally, alcohol can be very important. And also certainly anyone who drinks is not an alcoholic. You know, we should support anyone who chooses not to drink for any reason, but also there is nothing wrong with drinking in moderation. And in some cases, it's also been shown to have health benefits. So individual choice, y'all. Enjoy your alcohol this month or don't. I support you either way. These were some really great questions. And thank you too for sort of the added information as well. As you can see, it's really a much more rich and complex topic than it's really given credit for, which is why I was motivated to put this talk together. So happy January. I hope to see you all again soon. And thank you so much for coming this evening. Good night, everybody. Good night, Chelmsford Library. See you soon.
Good night. Thanks for coming.
My pleasure.